So I'll start the recording here for those of you watching the screencast. Just to reiterate kind of the main point at the end of lecture on Tuesday, this normalizing term, I encourage all of you to think of this as a normalizing term. It doesn't depend on the state, but it ensures that this is a proper probability. We usually are not going to calculate that, and that will turn out to be true when we're doing our particle filters as well. And so what we end up with is a probability that's proportional to the probability we're interested in, but it doesn't include this normalization term. So it's what we want within a scale factor. And so we need to account for that somehow. And so last time we talked about, well, what happens in that case when we have not the true probability we're interested in, but instead we have something that's proportional to it. So we know what it is within some scale factor. And it turns out that within this framework, we can figure out pretty quickly what the bias is by taking essentially an estimate of the mean of a constant function. This is kind of the mathematical trick by which you can arrive at the normalization factor. We know the expected value of a constant is that constant. So when we calculate the expected value of 1, we should get 1. But when we do it with this biased estimate of the probability, what we get instead is that scaling factor. And that scaling factor most simply ends up being this equation right here. So if we divide our estimate by that scaling factor, then suddenly we end up with an unbiased estimate. So there's always this normalization step you do when you're in that situation, which is what we'll be for with the particle filters. So so after a little bit of math, you can still express this as a weighted sum of the nonlinear function evaluated at each of the samples that you're drawing from your importance density, but in this case, these weights first have to be normalized. You calculate your initial weights as the ratio, and then you normalize them so that basically they sum to 1. You divide them by the sum of the weights themselves, and that step is called weight normalization. Particle filters use it. It's super simple, and it eliminates the need to worry about that bottom probability that otherwise would be difficult to contend with. So problem solved. Is that okay? That's all review. So what's new, where we're going to pick up today, and what's new is thinking a little bit more about impulse functions. And I have to put in a qualifier here and maybe even an apology on behalf of engineers. Oh, and you know, I'm sorry, I just thought of something. I have to do a little bit of an aside. Walt did a really nice job presenting his homework, but I'm just curious, did anyone else count how many Star Wars references he made? Star Wars, excuse me. Did anyone count them?
I'm ashamed. He made Star Wars references?
There were 3.
Oh my God.
He made 3.
Something is strong with this one.
That was one of them. There was I'm counting when he says Portland Weirdy. He said someone coming in with a Darth Vader mask.
No, that was a Unipiper reference. That wasn't a Star Wars reference.
Oh, all right. That was a fail on my part. Then.
I caught the Unipiper.
I didn't know he had a formal name.
His name is the Unipiper. That's what his website is.
Oh, he has a website.
I know what
he rides a bat. He carries a bagpipe that shoots flames out of it. He rides a unicycle, wears a Darth Vader mask and a kilt, and he rides around playing bagpipe.
I think I can still count that as a Star Wars reference.
It's short.
Yeah.
It's a second degree Star Wars reference.
Yeah, there was a third one too. I don't remember exactly what it was, but there was a third.
It's just part of my speech now. It's canonical, you know. It's language.
I'm glad. I thought I didn't know other people would be as into it as old people like me. But anyway,
so how did you feel about the new one then?
I liked it.
Okay.
Yeah, it was good. I was happy with that. Far better than episodes 1 through 3. Far better. I was very glad they took Lucas away from the director's chair. So anyways, getting back to this. So apology on behalf of engineers to mathematicians. When I talk to my mathematician colleagues, or when I have a student in the class that has a degree in mathematics, I always have to apologize a little bit about the use of this impulse, because we go through and blithely write this equation as though you can integrate a function that is infinitely tall and infinitesimally wide. And when I show this to my colleagues in the math department, they say, well, what on earth do you mean by that integral sign? And, you know, what does this even mean? I don't get it. They say, are you doing measure theory? I mean, if so, then tell me what your measure is and talk to me about those elements. So We play sort of fast and loose with this impulse function as engineers, and we act as though we can integrate it, and there's no problem. And we say, well, really, we're talking about something in the limit anyway. It doesn't really have to be infinitely tall and infinitesimally wide. We think of it as a bump, and it's just a bump that gets really narrow. And the mathematicians are unsatisfied because technically a lot of integrals are also defined as limits. And when you've got a limit where you've got an infinite sum where the bin width is getting really small, but now you're summing something that's getting infinitesimally small also, there's sort of a race, and it's not clear who's going to win or what happens with convergence of those limits. But as engineers, we just sort of ignore all that, and trust me that if you do this properly with measure theory, which I myself don't know, this all works out. It's okay. We can still pretend that we can integrate these functions and that it's just a Riemann sum and that things work just fine, like we learned in undergraduate math. But let me tell you, there's far more to it than what we typically learn, and I just have to acknowledge that because I don't want the mathematicians to make fun of us, especially since apparently thousands of either people or robots watch these lectures at some point. So that's the mathematical disclaimer, and that's my statement about this getting to be a little bit dicey. That being said, I'm going to now move on as though everything is fine. And as engineers, this is the Dirac delta function. So the big property it has is that when you integrate it, it has unit area. It's really tall and it's really narrow, and the balance of those two is that its area is 1. And the thing that's a little bit different in this class than probably what you've seen in other classes, like on linear systems, is that now we're thinking of x as being multidimensional. So one change from what you may have seen before is that in this class we're talking about the multivariate version of the impulse function. So when you see this, think of x as a vector and a as a vector. And if any element of that difference vector is non-zero, then the Dirac is equal to delta. I'm sorry, the Dirac function is equal to zero. And it's only when the vector x is equal to the vector a that it's non-zero, and it's something that is really big. The other property this has is that when you integrate, and again, you should think of this as a multivariate integral for this class, because usually x will be the state of the system, and so it's a vector. So this is a vector integral. Then we still have the same property that if you integrate a function, an arbitrary function of x times an impulse located at some vector value of a, then that's equal to the function evaluated at the value of a. So the same ideas that you learned in the scalar case more or less apply in the vector case. And so the multivariate version can also be written as a product of the univariate versions. It's very rare that I need to refer to an element of a vector. So if you've got a 10-dimensional vector and I want to refer to the fifth element, I will try to do that as parentheses. And it's an awkward, sort of clumsy notation, but I so rarely need to refer to an element that I'm using that here. And so I'm kind of apologize for the parentheses around parentheses, but you get the idea that one way of thinking about the multivariate impulse is it's just a product of the univariate impulses for each dimension of the vector. Yeah? Okay. Great. So one way of understanding particle filters, and this is a somewhat different perspective. There's a number of ways of getting at this. Before, we were talking about evaluating an integral as drawing random numbers and then evaluating a sum, and it beats the curse of dimensionality. That was the story. But now I'm going to go about this differently. So this is taking another run at a different understanding that will get us to the same answer. So this is talking about estimating a mean in a very different way, where instead of thinking of a PDF as some nicely behaved, smooth, continuous function of the independent variable, now we're going to mess it up and think of a PDF as being a sum of impulses. So we've got big N of these impulses, and we're going to say our estimate is simply a sum of impulses. Each of these has unit area, and so if you were to integrate this thing, because there's, I should have put it in here, but the limit obviously goes from I equals, I guess I can go from 1 to big N. So there's n terms in the sum, and so in each of these terms has unit area, so the sum has a total area of n. You divide by n, this clearly has unit area. It's clearly only ever takes on positive values. It's never negative, so it meets those two criteria to make it kind of a valid probability. It's very weird, and I'll talk about that weirdness in a minute. But one way of understanding particle filters is to think of it as estimating the states or the trajectories as basically being some collection of weighted impulses. So, but in this case, we'll just think about the scalar case for now. And if we say we've got an estimate of the probability that is just some, let's say, unweighted, or all the weights are uniform, some average of impulses, so that's our representation. Then if we say, well, the mean, we know the way we would normally calculate the mean is by evaluating this integral, but now we've got an estimate of the probability that's in kind of a special form that makes our life, it turns out, far easier. If our probability really can be represented this way, then if we substitute this in as our approximation of the true probability, then what we end up with is an integral of impulses, an integral of a sum of impulses. And both of these are linear operations, so you can change the order. We can bring the sum outside or push the integral to the right, if you will, bring the integral inside. We have to carry f of x with it, but we move that inside. And when we do so, we end up with an integral of f of x times each individual impulse that is located at xi. And again, I is an index. This is not x to the power of I. That's just an index for the ith particle or ith element that we randomly chose. And the nice thing about this is based on that nice property of the delta impulse, this is simply the function evaluated at that particle value. And so this becomes then very simply a sum. What was a problem, in at least in high dimensions, of evaluating this integral, if we have a representation of this probability or an approximation of that probability that is in the form of being a sum of impulses, or as we'll see, a weighted sum of impulses, then the integral problem ends up being simply a sum. And that's really nice. That's something we can actually do computation with. You know, it eliminates this problem of, oh my gosh, we're in this really high-dimensional space, we've got this high-dimensional integral we need to evaluate, and we can only evaluate this point-wise, and oh my gosh, that's such a computational disaster. But if we've got this approximation, then we end up with this, which is really nice. And this is very similar to what we arrived earlier on a different path. But if we want to estimate the mean, one way of thinking about it is we're still doing an integral, it's just that we've now expressed the estimated probability in this very special form that makes that easy.
I'm a little confused on the notation in the delta function. So x to the I is the ith unit of the vector, or the ith element of the vector?
No.
Okay. What is
that? So we, if I'm representing the probability as the sum of impulses that are located at the xi's, mm-hmm. and later these xi's will be what we're calling the particles. But
those are position vectors of the multidimensional impulses?
Yes.
Such that they only evaluate to the... Do they only turn on at that position?
Correct.
Okay.
The impulse is only non-zero when x is equal to the xi's. And the xi's are randomly chosen. My only hesitation in affirming that they're positions is I of course, don't mean physical positions.
Yeah. State vectors. They're only on at that particular multidimensional state values, set of state values.
Thank you. Yes, that's correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
The logic behind the integral is the exact same as for the single dimensional delta, but you're just doing like an ith order integral over the various dimensions, and then you'll get out the position, you'll get out whatever the function is at that particular state, set of state values?
Almost. I think the only difference from what you said is that I has nothing to do with the dimension of the vector.
Oh yeah, it's the number of the state value.
Number of elements that
okay.
we have. And I'll use the term particles, but it's basically the number of elements that we're using to represent this probability. This estimate of the probability is completely defined by wherever those elements are located. and we have n of those, but usually I'll denote the dimension of the vector x with a lowercase letter m, which I think is consistent with the text.
Do we allow two different xi's to be the same?
Yes. In fact, we'll end up sort of deliberately making them the same, at least temporarily. You'll see that's coming.
Is the accuracy of the estimate then related to the number of n, or basically n?
Yeah, the more n, the better. But when we talk about accuracy of the estimate, it gets to be really, really weird. And I'll talk about that. In fact, I guess I'm going to talk about that here, but I'll show an example, and I'll talk more about it in the context of the example. So I'm now suggesting you think of an estimate of a probability as being, and a better way of expressing this, rather than a sum of impulses, in this case, it's really an average of impulses. Each of those impulses has unit area, and this is, we're dividing the sum by the number of terms, so it's probably better to think of this as an average or a sample average. So we've got an average of n impulses. And, you know, earlier we arrived at an estimator by the law of large numbers. We ended up at exactly the same estimator that we did this time by instead starting off with saying we've got a probability that is represented as an average of impulses. And so that's kind of nice. And we know that this estimate of the mean, and again, this is an arbitrary function of x. So if you're interested in not maybe estimating the state, but maybe some nonlinear function of the state, this is the way in which you would estimate it. I'll say more about that later, but this is an arbitrary function of the state. Often we just want to know the state, but if you want a function of the state, this is the way you would estimate it. But you should think carefully about my suggestion. You know, I put a hat mark on this probability, but you should think carefully about whether it's reasonable to say that this is an approximation of PDF, especially the kind of PDFs that you just saw now in homework 2 and homework 1 for that matter, where a good visual model of what these PDFs look like is that they have some number of modes. But those modes are not impulses. Those modes are bumps. You know, your posterior has bumps. It'll be in a high-dimensional space, but you saw it from now homework 2 and the examples I've shown you in class that these are kind of bumps. In fact, you could represent it as a sum of Gaussians, for example, or an average of Gaussians, weighted average of Gaussians. So now I'm going to the extreme, and rather than talking about bumps, I'm talking about impulses. This is very different. Let's look at an example. Here is what an approximation of a Gaussian PDF would look like. And of course, I can't really draw impulses that are going up to infinity. So each vertical line, of course, is representing the location of an impulse that reaches up towards infinity and is infinitesimally wide, but has unit area. So the locations of the impulses are shown by the black lines. And by the way, is this too washed out for you guys, or is it okay with my slides?
Okay,
if we get to an image where you guys want to cut the light so you can see it better, I mean, feel free, we can do it. I'm reluctant, especially at the end of the day, to have dim lights because it'll put people to sleep. But if we need to, we could certainly see Walt's slides a lot better when we did that and see those images. So, and you know, I know that textbooks always put arrows on the impulses, but when you've got so many of them, it would just end up being all blurred together. So I didn't do that. So just got vertical lines and that's it. So if I were to show you this PDF visually, as I've shown here, if I were on the final quiz for the term, I'd say, look, here's an estimate of a PDF. Tell me what the distribution is. Do you think that's uniform Gaussian or Cauchy or something else? Like, there's no way you'd be able to do it. I couldn't do it. Because when you're looking at these impulses, like, visually you just can't make it out. And in fact, it's very different in some ways than this nice, smooth Gaussian that it's approximating, because although there's more of them in the region where it's denser, any point that you would pick on this line, except for n discrete points, would be zero, right? The estimate would be exactly zero. If I say, what's the probability at this point right here according to your estimate, you would say zero. And that's going to be true virtually everywhere. If you were to pick a random number, the odds of you picking a random number where one of those impulses happened to be is zero. Like, you wouldn't land on one if you tried. If you were just guessing randomly, you would never find them. So it's a very weird way of thinking about approximating this Gaussian function. It's infinity whenever it's non-zero, and when it is, and it's non-zero almost everywhere. I mean, it's so strange. So in what respect can we really argue that this collection of impulses is a good model of that Gaussian? That's something that you should have a good answer to. And the answer, I think, should be that they're the same, that when you integrate with them, you get similar results. So the only thing we're ever going to do really with this probability is, well, I shouldn't say that because we'll do other things, but often we're trying to calculate an expected value. Sometimes we're calculating a percentile if we want to estimate the median. Modes are very tricky with this representation. I know that you've seen examples now where tracking a mode in your posterior is a very good thing to do. But when you've got this representation, you've got n modes that are infinitely high, and they're not necessarily the real modes of your probability. So you have to be very careful when you're dealing with this and you're picking modes. And I can tell you that most people that work with particle filters, when they want to pick a mode, they do it wrong. They pick the one with the maximum weight, and that's absolutely the wrong thing to do, and I'll say more about that later. But in any case, you got to be careful with modes. But if you're integrating, and you are integrating when you're taking an expected value, then this turns out to be a reasonable thing. As we saw before, our approximation of the mean of an arbitrary nonlinear function approaches the true mean as 1 over... the square root of n in standard deviation based on basically the law of large numbers. So that's great. And when you're doing a median, it turns out you're safe also, because the median can be expressed as is basically the point at which an integral is equal to 0.5. So if you're using median, you're fine with this approximation. Just be careful with modes, and I'll say more about that later. That turns out to be tricky. Even though it's desirable, there are applications where you want a mode, but it's tricky.
I'm sorry, I may have missed this, but where did we get the positions of the impulses from?
We started off talking about Monte Carlo integration, and the way that we chose the values by which we were evaluating those sums was randomly based on some importance density. Okay. And so it's from the importance density. We have a distribution from which we're drawing random numbers, and that's where these xi come from.
I go back in.
So as I've said before, in our application, this p of x ends up being the posterior, or the previous posterior, and we can't draw samples from it. We can evaluate it at any value of x that we want to, so we can evaluate the probability point-wise, but it's a multidimensional probability, and as such, it's very difficult to draw random numbers from that probability. So there will be something else, this importance density, where this is also a PDF, but it uses the letter Q because we put P and Q together a lot as with the same independent variable. So this is the only other symbol I use to represent PDFs. This is the importance density that we talked about last time, and that's the distribution from which we will actually draw samples. And what that ends up doing for our estimate of the PDF is, rather than taking an average, we end up taking a weighted average. And the weights are exactly what we talked about before. So it's the ratio of the probability that we want to draw samples from divided by the PDF that we can actually draw samples from. So there's exactly that same ratio we saw before, and this ends up being the equivalent representation of the probability function. And it converges in the same manner as what we saw before when we were just doing Monte Carlo integration directly. But we didn't think about this as a representation of the underlying approximate probability, and that's one way of thinking about it. Now, this gets to be even weirder. Now, we still have a representation of our PDF by these black lines, So still, if you were to throw a dart at this thing and say, what's your estimate of the PDF, it would still be zero. You wouldn't land on an impulse, but if you did happen to, it would be infinitely tall at that impulse. But now the area of those impulses varies. And what I've plotted here is the area of the impulses, which is what I'm graphically depicting by the heights of the black lines. And the weights are given as ratio of the true probability, which is the Gaussian shown in blue, divided by the importance. And in this case, I assume the importance was a T distribution, which has heavier tails than a Gaussian distribution. And when you look at this, now the weights out here are relatively small because it's more probable we're going to put impulses out there than the true PDF that we're trying to draw samples from. So when we do get values out there, they get a smaller weight. And, conversely, in here, where these peaks happen to be, there the ratios are a little bit different, and so they're higher. So now I'm asking you to take one more step and think of the probability, the approximate probability, as being a weighted sum of impulses, or weighted average would be a better way to say that. Yeah, Colin?
So in this slide, the function that we wanted to integrate is a Gaussian, and we decomposed it into a student's T distribution and something else?
Not quite. Let me express it this way. So we ultimately wanted to evaluate some integral g of x dx. And we said, well, this is mostly a review. Let's say instead that g of x can be written as a product of some function of x times some PDF, p of x. So that was one of the steps we took last time. And then we said, well, we have a problem because, you know, if we end up integrating this, everything looks good. This ends up being the integral of f of x now times this PDF, which is just equal to the expected value of f of x, which we can approximate, again, with a Monte Carlo integration or experiment. But we have to draw samples from the p of x, which we can't do. So what we do instead is we say, let's say instead we can draw samples from a q of x, and now what we're going to integrate or try to integrate is f of x times p of x divided by q of x times q of x dx. So this is clear this the same as what we have over here. I just multiplied by q of x and divided by q of x. But now this is something that we can write as the expected value of f of x times p of x divided by q of x, which is all fine. And this is based on drawing samples, you know, when we generate our approximation, drawing samples now from this importance density that we get to pick. So when you're looking at these things, the you can even do this in color. This is our p of x. And the red function here is, or the red trace, is our q of x. That's what I've plotted. And weights, which are this term here, the weights are the ratio of basically the blue over the red. And so what we're looking at in the height is the ratio of these two, kind of our weighting function.
But if p of x is a Gaussian, why can't you sample from that?
Oh, I could have. In this particular example, I could have actually drawn samples from it.
Okay.
But now I'm going to take away your Gaussian random number generator. And in general, like you saw in Walt's homework presentation, and hopefully in your own homework, the probability that we end up with, this ends up being the posterior, and it's this multidimensional, multimodal thing that's kind of nasty. And the idea of being able to draw samples from it is just not feasible, practically. But you could certainly draw samples from some other distribution, such as a uniform distribution or Gaussian distribution. Lots of random number generators are readily available to draw from a distribution of your choosing, And then everything works fine if you just take the expected value of f of x times this ratio, and that ratio is our weight. Our weights when we evaluated the samples. Yeah, is it okay? I know it's a lot to take in.
It's just that I want to see an example of taking an actual function and decomposing it into this f of x and p of x. Does that make sense, or do you not do that analytically?
Well, it turns out I can't quite do the equations from memory. Actually, I might be able to, but I'm not going to attempt it. The nice thing is that we end up already having our g of x. Let me back up. Generally, Monte Carlo integration can be used to evaluate high-dimensional integrals and get estimates of what their values are of any function, independent of the context of state-space tracking, the topic of this class. But that being said, and you have to factor it, you know, your function in this way, and I did one example where you had a uniform distribution, and then g of x is just equal to some scalar times f of x. That was a very simple example that we did before. But in our context of state-space tracking, when we look at the optimal Bayesian recursions, the thing that we're integrating is already factored as a function times a probability. And if I remember correctly, the function ends up simply being the what I call the prior probability, the state transition probability, and this ends up being the posterior at the previous time step. So it's already factored for us in the way that we're going to be applying this, and that's why I'm not providing you with a lot of examples of, well, how do you take that nonlinear function and factor it in this way? Well, we're only going to do it once. And it's already factored for us, so we don't really have to do anything.
That's the Chapman-Kolmogorov integral you're talking about.
Correct.
Before. So that's already in two parts. But you already have a prior and a likelihood in there, so, or a prior and the.
Yeah, I think it was the prior and the posterior at the previous time step, if I remember correctly. I mean, I'll pull all this together just in a bit when we talk about particle filters. But the reason I'm not giving you a lot of examples is I'm not really trying to teach you about Monte Carlo integration. I'm just teaching you how to apply it to one case. So there's one integral in which we'll apply it to. And then the real question is going to be, okay, and how do you pick this importance density? Because as engineers, you all know there's going to be trade-offs involved. And you can't really just pick anything you want and everybody's happy. Like, it matters. And okay. and we'll talk about that.
So that was going to be my question. So here you've picked the student t distribution because it's kind of close to a Gaussian. But in that case, you knew something that it was a Gaussian, and so you picked this other one that was close to it. So do you have to kind of?
They don't have to be close. And honestly, the only reason I picked student's t distribution is because it was the first thing that came to mind. And it was easily available in MATLAB. When I wrote this, I did it in MATLAB. I could not have chosen a uniform distribution in this case because it doesn't have the same support as the Gaussian. I could have waved my hands and said, well, if I go out plus or minus 5 sigma, it's good enough. But I could have chosen really anything. I could have chosen a Cauchy distribution. Like anything that has the same support as the PDF we're interested in, I could have chosen, and it would have been fine.
Maybe for next class, like switch them, because we're all used to sampling with the Gaussian.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, that's a really good idea. So, yeah, thank you. It's a good suggestion.
Is there some concrete interpretation of choosing that as your importance distribution? Like, maybe you care about outliers a lot more, and so you want to weight them more heavily?
Well, rather than talking about the general case, I'm eager to talk about the state-space tracking case, and there's a few more things, a few more ideas we need to get through before I can get to that. So I'm gonna ask that you hold that question. I'll give you a good answer, but I can't quite do it yet. Any other questions on this example? Okay. Oh, nice. So Monte Carlo integration gives us a way of integrating in high dimensions. That's essentially why we're talking about it. Because when we start off with the optimal Bayesian recursions for the marginal posterior probability, we ended up with this multidimensional integral that we couldn't practically handle. And Monte Carlo integration is potentially a way out of that. It's equivalent. This is strange, but it's equivalent to representing PDFs as sums, or I should have said probably averages, or better still, weighted averages of impulses. And in general, you've got to use important sampling, especially in our context for the one integral we care about, because you can't usually sample from the probability that you want to sample from. So that's why important sampling shows up. So again, weighted sums, or I should probably update these slides so it says weighted averages of impulses. So it's good to have that visual in your mind when you're thinking about particle filters and what we're going to be doing. And once you've got this representation of the PDF, it's really easy to take the expected values of nonlinear functions. You're just taking a sample average of those functions evaluated at wherever your impulses happen to be or wherever your particles happen to be. Super easy. And likewise, it's pretty easy to get percentiles, including the median. I should also emphasize that I didn't mention this earlier, but when you've got this representation of impulses, you can get other percentiles besides the 50th percentile, which is really slick because that means that particle filters enable you to estimate confidence intervals, which is great for a lot of our applications. We want to know not just where is an estimate, but how good is your estimate, because that affects decisions, whether they're controlled decisions made by an algorithm or decisions made by a person based on the estimates that you're generating. So it's awesome that if we can have this representation and it's accurate in the sense that we can integrate accurately with it, then you can get percentiles as well.
So you mentioned before you have to be able to evaluate this PDF at points, right, in order to get that PQ weight value. Have you covered yet how you actually evaluate that from Dirac's? Did I miss that, or are we
going to
go over that?
We'll go over it. In our context, we'll go over it. Like our context of state space tracking, it's not a problem. All right. Well, that's it for Monte Carlo integration. So I'll stop the recording here.